Welcome to today's lecture. Today we will move on with the Java track, and we will take a look at basic object-oriented concepts like classes and methods, encapsulation, interfaces, and exceptions. So we will just continue with pure Java stuff. First of all, what do we mean by modularization? When you're about to design a system, so far the exercises in the assignments has been very, very tiny. But in general, you will be facing much larger problems. And for example, you and your team is working on developing some administrative system for a bank or something like this. Once you have a good idea about what you're about to do, you must start by dividing the problem into smaller parts. You are saying that this system will require a database, a graphical user interface, and so forth. You start by dividing it in larger chunks, and then you take these smaller chunks and you divide it into smaller components. This process is called modularization. We are dividing the problem into smaller and smaller parts until we have reached the smallest components that are called classes. A class is our basic building block. In the end, our entire program will be a large number of classes that are interacting in different ways to solve the problem. So a good component in this sense is, at least in object-oriented program, it represents something concrete. You should try to find components that is a student, an employer, a record, or something like this, something concrete. And then you make one class or a few classes to model each one of them. A good component should also be easy to understand by themselves. They shouldn't depend on something else. You should be able to read the code and it should make sense. We are describing a student, then you take a look at the code and it says, yes, it looks like a student description, this one. And they should have a logical and easy to understand interface. I will often emphasize that when you are programming and the way we are trying to teach you to do your program is you are a part of a team. You will write code and 10 other people will read your code. It is essential that you are trying to make a code that is easy to understand. So if you give a class a logical name, student, and you give a logical method names, get name of student or something like this, then basically your colleagues don't have to see your code. Just by looking at the method's name, they know what they are doing. So a good class is designed with someone else in mind. Someone else should use your class. That's one of the key things. Anyway, if we find components that look like this and have these properties, then the other advantage is that they are, if they are modeling concrete entities, something that we understand, then they are easy to understand. And if things that are easy to understand comes with less errors. If what you're trying to describe is something vague and fuzzy, then you will also come up with, make more errors in your code. And also, assume that I'm developing a class that represents a student. I might find this class useful in many other applications, not only as for one system, but in all other systems that are related to classes. I can find this one. So the idea and the ideal is that we are modeling them and we do a good job the first time, then hopefully we can make use of this class in many, many different applications. So do it carefully and always have in mind that you are a part of a team. Someone else will read your code. In average, they are saying that every code written by a programmer is read by 10 other programmers. In the end, after a while, 10 other people have been there trying to read the code and try to understand it. If your code is messy, you will not be popular among your colleagues. So it will sort out itself. Another keyword is abstraction. I said that modularization is to identify suitable classes to model the system. However, classes should model a real-world entity, but real-world entities are often very complex. Once again, take the student example. If I should model you, for example, in all your details, it would be very messy. I would practically have to have your complete DNA together with all your memories and experiences and things like this. It would be a hopeless task. So model a real-world entity in detail in general is, of course, impossible. What we have to do is to say that, okay, you here, in this context at the university, we don't care about your school shoe size or something like this. There are only a few facts that are relevant. Your ID number, since you're in Sweden, and what courses you have taken, your grades and things like this. So in the end, out of all your properties, we select 10 that we consider to be the one that we should keep track of. And this is the abstraction phase. A class contains those properties that are relevant in a given problem domain. We are saying that we make an abstraction. It is a real-world entity that we try to model, but in this context, we only keep track of a certain facts. They are the only one that we need. Here I have as an example my many faces. At work, they are thinking that certain properties, position, institute, and salary are the important one, while at my bank, they are using a different set of properties to describe me. And at my golf club, they have a third set of properties. So the abstraction phase is context dependent in the sense that you are modeling something, but you should select properties that are relevant in this particular context. If I'm asking you to write the class that describes a student, you should ask me in what context. Otherwise, it's a hopeless task. It should be, you should describe a student as a part of our administrative system, keeping track of your grades and something like this, then it's a doable task. A class, if I should define what I mean by a class in one sentence, I would say that a class describes an abstraction of a real-world entity. That's my best line of saying what a class is. A good class describes something, a real-world entity, but in order to be manageable, we must do an abstraction. And you will see that classes consist of properties and behavior. Properties are the data that comes with it. For example, a student comes with the data, their address, their ID number, pure data related to it. And the behavior is what we can do with it. We can update the grades, we can do things with it. So in a class, we have fields, they describe the data, the properties, and we have methods that describes what we can do with a class or with an object. So for example, a class time might look like this. We are describing an ordering point in time by hours, minutes, and seconds. These are the data. And the behavior is, what can we do with a time object? Well, we can ask it what is the hours, minutes, and seconds, and we can also update it and say, okay, I'm changing the seconds from 22 to 45 or something like this. So a class comes with two parts, properties and behavior, and in Java, we will say that we have fields. The fields are the one that carries the data, and the methods are the one that tells us what we can do with an object of this type. Another example, just to remind you of the difference of class and objects. Here I have something that illustrates a class called car. Each car has a manufacturer, a model, and a registration number. These are the facts we associate with a car. And also what we can do with it, we can update these facts about it. So this is a class describing what a car should look like. And then we have the objects, they are individual cars. one particular car is a Volvo, another one is a Jaguar, and a third one is a Ford. So a class is something that describes what all the objects should look like. And an object is a particular car, a particular student, or a particular employee, or something like this. This is the first example of a class in Java. First of all, remember from the first lecture, if you have a class named person, it must be saved in a file named person.java. This one is not executable by itself. You cannot run a class. You must have a main method that initiates person objects. So, but this is a class that describes a person. Yeah, I have done here a very rough approximation, abstraction of a person. A person comes with a name, a height, and a weight. These are the data. Every person comes with a name, a height, and a weight. Then, so these are the fields carrying the facts, the data about the person. Then we have a type of entities that are called the constructors. They are used in the code to create new persons. Later on, I will show how to use them. But basically, they are called to initialize these methods, this data. You're calling this constructor, and you're providing a name, a height, and a width. And what they do in here is they're saying, OK, the input parameter n should be assigned to the name. The input parameter h should be assigned to the height, and so forth. And then I also have something called the default constructor. I'm just giving them nonsense values here to start with. I can later on use the set name and set height methods to update them. But this is a very simple example of a class. The syntax is public class person. Then we have a number of fields, we have a number of constructors, and we have a number of methods. I think it is on the. Let's move to this one. Okay, in one file I have typed down my class, the person class. Then I open a new file with the main method, and inside the main method I can write this code. It starts by saying, I would like to create a new person named Jonas, H, with a certain length and a certain weight. When the execution reaches this part, we are creating a person with these facts. And we are storing a reference to this object in this variable, and then we can ask this object print person, and it will print Jonas 183 and 70. I create a new person. This time I'm using the default constructor. I don't provide any input values. I'm just saying, give me an empty person. And then I use the set methods. Set Jesper, set name to Jesper, set height to 188 and weight to 104. And then I print the data. So in this case, we have two pieces of code. We have the main method containing this one that is using this class, which is in another file. Here I describe what we mean by a person, what data it has, how we can construct it, and what we can do with it. This defines the properties of all person objects. Here I'm using it. Does it make sense? Yeah. Think of a class, if you've done programming in other languages, as well, you have probably used methods or functions. You define a function somewhere and you're calling the function at some other place. Here we are defining a class somewhere and we are using it at some other place. Let's see what we had over here. So an object-oriented program or a Java program, they are basically a number of classes that are and when you're executing it, you're creating objects of these classes, and these objects are interacting with each other. So a Java program is a set of class definitions. And a class usually consists of fields, methods, and constructors. Fields were the data we associate with a person, the name and the height. Methods are what you can do with it, update the height and ask it for its name. And the constructors are the methods that are used when we are using this new person. They are telling us how do we initialize a new object. Together, these are called class members. I added here a class usually consists of, there are a few other entities that you can have inside a class. You can have classes inside another class, for example. But to start with, think of them as these are the three building blocks of a class. Another example, a stack. Do you know what a stack is? It's a data structure. I often think of a stack as just a pipe where you can only do operations on one side of the stack. You can insert an element. It is called push. You can pick it out. It is called pop. You insert it and you pick it out, it's called pop. You can also ask what is the top element here, then it's usually called peak. So it is a data structure where you are adding things using the push method and you're picking them out using the pop method, and you can ask what is on top using the peak method. I can use it like this. This is a stack for integers only. I create a new stack object, an empty stack, and then I'm iterating 10 times and I'm pushing the values 5, 10, 15, 20, up to 50. So I've added them. Then when I'm done, the top element here will be 50 in this case. And then I'm popping them, or no? Before I'm popping them, I'm asking the stack, what is your size? And I print it, and I ask it, what is the top element? It's 50. And then I use a while statement here, and the method is empty. And I said, as long as the stack is not empty, pop them one at a time and print them. It will print 50, 45, do you understand this code? And do you understand what a stack is? Implementing a stack is something you can do very compact. This is a class implementing a stack. In order to implement the stack, I need two types of data. I have an array of values, and I keep track which one is the first empty slot in my values array. So when I start, when I create a new int stack, I create an array of a certain size and I attach it up here. So once you have created an int stack, you have an array here of a certain size, and top points to the first empty slot, which is slot number 0. And when we are pushing an element, we are increasing top and we are inserting the element into the values array. So we have a corresponding array here, initially empty. When we are pushing the first element, we are adding it here. And we are moving top to point to this point in the stack. And then we are pushing one more time, then we're adding it here. And we are moving top to this. So this is the push method here. Pop means remove a value from the remove the last added value and decrease the value of this top that keeps track of the first empty slot and return it. What is the difference between top plus plus or plus plus top, if I should have written it?
I think top plus plus would be first add one. Then
look at the value, but minus minus top will first look for the top and then will decrease it by one. I think it's the opposite. top here. If I make this call, say top is 0. Then I will insert n into position 0. And once I'm done with operation, I increase its value. So that's why the operation comes afterwards. In here, we are first decreasing the value of top, and then we are picking out the element. I wanted to make it short to make it fit in one slide, but here I'm using these shortcut operators all the time. Did you understand this one? Start by, we are inserting it at position top, and then we are increasing top by 1. Here, we start by decreasing the value of top, and then we are reading the value in this new position. Top or peak is pick out the last added element. Is empty, we are asking it, are you empty? Then we are just comparing top with 0. If top is 0, it means we have no elements in the stack for the time being. And size means return top. So in order to describe this, the stack, I am using two entities, an integer array and a top, an integer keeping track of how many elements I have added. So these are the fields. They describe, they are the carrier of all the data related to the stack in its current situation. This, the constructor, are used to initialize the stack. I give it a certain set of values there. And then we have the methods here that are either removing elements or adding elements. And a method, they look something like this. They have an in parameter, they do something, and they have a return value. The push method, when we are adding something, we don't expect it to return anything at all. That's why we have this keyword void. It means a method that do something, but it doesn't return anything at all. The pop method doesn't have any in parameters. We're just asking the stack to pop an element. We don't need to provide any information to it. It doesn't have any in parameter. However, it returns an integer value. So this part of the method definition is called the signature. It gives it a name, it gives it any number of in parameters, and it gives it one return value, describing what will be returned from this method. Java can only return 1 or 0 values. And if it returns an integer, you must say that it's returning an integer. If it doesn't return anything, you're saying void. Yeah?
What I will ask might sound quite basic, but I was wondering.
Good question. I hope.
Yeah, I will see. So, do multidimensional stacks exist?
What would that be?
Would it make sense? Like, it's a stack, but it's not of one dimension.
I've never thought about the question. The question is, for those listening, do we have multidimensional stacks? And if a spontaneous answer is, I don't see when it should be used and how it should work.
Exactly.
Yeah. If we are allowing it to add elements over here and remove them over here, then it's a queue. In the next lecture, we will talk about basic data structures like this. I will use them here as an example of how to implement the class. But we will go in more detail how to implement them in general in better ways in the next lecture. But do we understand this one?
I have a question.
Yeah?
If the top exceeds the size value you gave to the stack initially, it wouldn't explode or anything?
If top would use, you mean the size here?
Yeah.
We are calling init stack this constructor call. This is the in parameter. We are then creating an array of this particular size, and we are attaching this array to this. So the size parameter is no longer existing. But we can ask for, we can always ask the array for what is your current length. Yeah, but we are not interested in the length in these operations. Well, it would be if you were asking, give me the final element when the array, when the stack is full. But in general, we are only keeping track of the first empty slot in this one. We don't care about what's in here. Yeah.
For example, then can you reach the 30th?
No. This is a very. The question is what happens when we are pushing more than 10, the size of the array. Then this program will crash. In the next lecture, or basically also later in this lecture, I will describe a better approach. We will keep track of the number of added elements, and when we are about to add one which is too large, we will create a new array which is much larger, move all the elements from the first array to the larger array, and then add the new one. So we will replace on demand when needed, we will replace this one with a larger one to make sure that it will never, we will never have too many elements. Let's move to another class implementation, a public class called Time. It describes ordinary daytime, hours, minutes, and seconds. You have a constructor here, so you can create a new time object like I do down here, giving it the hours, the minutes, and the seconds. After this constructor call, we will have a time object containing 12 hours, 35 minutes, and 56 seconds. So this is the one that we're using down here to initialize the time object. Once I have created a time object, I can ask print the time. It will print hours, minutes, and seconds like this. I can update the hours and say, well, I am not happy with the 12 hours. I would like the hours to be 345. And then I'm printing it. It looks like this. And then, what am I doing here?
Just assigning the value to the MS.
Yeah, I'm not using a method here. I'm writing directly to this one up here and saying that the field MS should now have this value. Yeah, that's the point I will reach in my next slide. Anyway, and then I'm printing the time here. It looks like this. And this is, of course, something is wrong here. This doesn't make any sense, a time that looks like this. Who is to blame? The guy implementing the class or the guy using the class?
The guy that implemented.
Yeah, I would say that the guy implemented this one is partially responsible. If you try to sign an hour to say 345, the class should react in some way saying that this is not doable. So this is a poor time implementation. Time problems. It doesn't recognize unrealistic values, data. Times like this should never be permitted. And the idea to solve this is to encapsulate the time data. That means we should make it impossible for a user to insert a value which is not correct. Well, they can try to insert it, but we should recognize them and stop them and say, this is not okay. So this part, making sure that you are protecting the field values of an object, is called encapsulation. And it turns out that companies that are sloppy using this one, they don't care about encapsulation, they will have a lot of errors in their code in the end. So people always nowadays try to encapsulate the data. And we are also saying that the one responsible for the for that the data is always correct is the one implementing the class. So what we should do is if someone wants to add to update the hours with an unrealistic value, we should have an if statement in the set method saying that if hours is larger than 24, we should react it. This is encapsulation. So the advantages is that all objects have a consistent state at all times, always realistic values of the fields. We will also see that the part of encapsulation is that implementation details are hidden. We would like the user should basically only see these four methods. What he can do with the time. He can create them, he can change the hours, and he can ask it to print its time. Everything else should be hidden from him. He shouldn't care about it. He shouldn't do anything that is based on some internal knowledge of the structure of the class. The internal structure is the responsibility for the implementer, the guy who is the programmer. The user should only use this one in a correct way. And if he tries to misuse them, the implementer is responsible of saying this is not correct. Yeah.
So what's the meaning of the first advantage?
One more time.
What are some advantages in the first class? All objects have a consistent state at all times.
Yeah.
What is the meaning of the first?
Consistent, I mean reasonable values in the fields. The hours are only between 0 and 24. The minutes are between. They should have reasonable values. A student shouldn't have incorrect birth date. They shouldn't be 350 years old, for example. Oops. A better time implementation takes care of this, but of course this starts to get a bit more messy than the classes. First of all, in order to prevent that you can write directly to the field, you should always make the fields private. By saying private here, it means that they can only be accessed from within the class itself. So every class you're making, or 99% of all cases, make sure that the fields are private. Otherwise, no matter what you do downhill will matter, they can write directly to the field and ruin the state of the object. And then the set methods. These are the ones that are used to update the fields. They should contain some check that the input value is reasonable. I do it here with a method called check range. It takes a time and it takes a maximum value. And then I check if the time is larger than or equal to 0 and at the same time end less than max, then it's okay. Otherwise, I print an error message here and return false. We are using this method here. Set hours, a user is trying to set the new hour. I call this method with max hours 24. If it is less than or equal to if it's 0 or larger and less than 24, this method will return true and we will execute this code. Otherwise, nothing will happen apart from an error message. Do you understand how this one works together with this one? When you try to, every time you try to update the hours, we are checking that the range is correct. If it is correct, then we are updating this field, hours, with a new value h assigned to r. Otherwise, we are in this case, we are printing an error message, we are returning false, and the false will prevent us from executing this line of code. Okay? Yes? Question?
Yeah. About the private help method.
Yeah.
Except the fact that we don't have to rewrite code in several places, does it have any other advantage?
No. Since we in the set minutes method, we will do the same thing. The only difference is that we will have a different max. So the reason why I don't include this code directly in here is that I will have three in the set hour, set minutes, and set seconds. They will look exactly the same. Why shouldn't you have code that looks exactly the same? Sooner or later you find an error in this copy and paste code. And then you will probably fix it in one place, maybe in the second and the third place, but in the fourth place you will not update it. So every time in your code when you start to see that you have, let's say, three or four lines of code that are identical, and you use them in several places, you should take this code and move it to a separate method and call this method instead. It is to avoid redundancy, and redundancy means that sooner or later you will fix some of them but not all of them. So, and you see here that this one, to check the range, I made it private. It is not intended to be used by the user of the time. It's an implementation detail how I handle the range check. So I've hidden it from the user in some sense. Okay. Also here, set hours. Every time we are about to update this field, everywhere in the program, we should use this method. So the basic idea to ensure encapsulation is first of all to make all the fields private. And then the set method, set hours, set minutes, should be responsible for checking whether the data is reasonable or not. And then all over your program, every time you would like to update the hours, you should use this method. This one is the one responsible for checking it. So you shouldn't, in some method down here, update this one. You should call this one and he takes care of the checking. Yeah? So, details, all fields are declared private, can only be accessed from within the class. All field accesses are made using the setX method. The setX method is responsible for checking the X data, basically. And you're using it all the time when you're updating the fields. We have a set of public methods intended for the external user, the one who is using the class. We have, in this case, one private method, check range. They are implementation details. They are not supposed to be used, and they cannot be used by some external user. What is the advantage of this thinking in terms of a public interface and internal details? Why is it important for us to in some way think of a class as it has a set, a public interface, a set of public methods that should be used, and we have some other methods and code that are not public?
Because using the class for other people in this way is easier. Some methods that are public, they can use them, and the details that is not useful for end users.
Yeah. In some way, it tells the user that these are the ones that should be used. But also for me as an implementer, I know that I can update the internal details. They are not using these ones. So if I come up with a better way of doing a range check, I know for sure that I can fix it. I can do this change. As long as I'm not changing the public interface, I can do updates on the internal code. So that's another one. So this is we are testing the encapsulated time class. We have inside some main method, we have this piece of code. We are creating a new encapsulated time object with these values. We are printing it. We are trying to give an illegal value for the hours. This will generate an out of range warning in the print statement I had previously, but it will not update the hour 21 here. It refuses to update it. Okay, we try to add the seconds 23. This one is okay, so it's accepted. And when I then print the time, we have the old time plus the updated seconds, but the hours are not changed. And this is the way we want it. The implementer of the class should not only recognize that something is wrong here, they should also give some hint to the user that you have done the mistake here. I will describe exceptions later on. Exceptions is the proper way in Java to do it. In this case, I only printed something on the screen. This will not work if it is a commercial software. They don't have any screen. So they will not see it in that case. I will talk about it later on. What is this one? System. What in the previous lecture I used what? System out. What is this? Error. It is a different channel to the screen, to the display. So if you are using this one in your Eclipse, it will come out in red. When you are writing error messages or warning messages, you can use this one to see. Then it will be easier to spot in the console that, oh, something was wrong here. I have got some red text in it. So when you write a message to the console while you are developing, choose between system out and system error. Error should signal that something is wrong.
So it will not compile? It will compile?
No, this is not an error. This is a logical error in the programming. And the compile, it's a perfectly good Java program. Yeah, this one will print this message in the console. I should introduce the name. Private and public that we've used so far, they are called access modifiers. Up to this point, we have used public and private, but later on in this course, you will see protected and other things. There are a few more access modifiers. But the important part here is just that you know about this name. What is an access modifier? Well, it's these words that are restricting how a certain method can be used or a field can be used. I have already talked about this, but when you are designing or implementing a class, I would like you to always have some external, some other guy who is using the code. You should not only write it for yourself, or not even for the teacher to read it. You should think about it as you are a team of programmers working together, and your code should be easy to understand and use for your colleague, in this case. The ideal case is it should be possible to use the class without detailed knowledge of the implementation. You have been using classes or from the Java library already. You don't know how they are implemented. You read a bit of documentation and then you start to use them. This is the ideal case. Your colleagues should not be forced to go and look into your code to see how it works in order to start using it. If you give it the proper name and a few lines of documentation, it should be enough for them to get started. So, my best advice is that when you're implementing a class, have this scenario in mind. Someone else will read the code. And you should mistrust them a bit. You should not expect them to follow the instructions and keep minutes less than 60 or something like this. You should expect them to break the rules once in a while, and then you should recognize it and give them a slap on the face and say, no, minutes must be 60 or less. Yeah? So, this is the view I have of a class. This is yet another class. In this case, it's a list. A list is like an array, but it grows. You can add things to it. You can ask, give me the element at a certain position. You can ask, do you contain a certain element and size? A number of things you can do with a list. We are needing, in this case, three sets of data, a set with three data up here to do the implementation. They are private and they are implementation details. These public, the constructor, add, get, contain, size, they are the public methods that we expect them to use. They should create the list and add elements to it and remove elements from it. So I look at this class as something like this. We are providing certain methods that we want the user. The user, he stands outside here somewhere, and he can use these guys. He shouldn't care about, and she shouldn't need to know anything about what's inside here. If you design your classes in this way that your friends and your colleagues never have to look up how they are implemented, then you have done a good job. If they need to look into your code and see what goes on in here in order to understand how to use this one, then you have made a mistake. So select descriptive method names and hide things that are not important. That's the important part. One more detail. In the Alex encapsulated time, I had a call in the constructor. Here, in the encapsulated time, in the constructor, when we are creating a new object, rather than writing this input parameter directly to the field, I was calling the set hours method here. It took care of checking that it was correct or not. This call here doesn't follow our usual approach of having a variable a and then we are calling a method like this. In the first lecture, we were creating a random generator and then we had storing it in a variable a equals new random, and then we were asking through this variable, we were asking this object, give me the next int or something like this. So the pattern for calling a method was have a variable referencing an object and then dot and then the method name. Who are we calling here? What?
Itself.
Yeah. When it calls itself, it doesn't have to point out and say, this is the one that I'm calling. Yeah. So this one, it means a call from the one method in the object to another method inside the same object. It's implicitly understood, so it doesn't follow this pattern. If you want to be explicit about it, you could actually write this set hours. This is a keyword in Java. It means the object is, it references itself. So this set hours has the same effect as just set hours. Sometimes you, when you're calling some other object, you would like this object to have a reference to yourself. Then you are submitting this. You give away a reference to yourself to them. But I am not using this approach. Inside a class, inside an object, if I would like to call myself, I just do it this way. Yeah, let's take a 10-minute break. But please, go ahead, ask your question.
Are we supposed to implement some exceptions, preventations in the basic exercises?
Later on this lecture, I will introduce exceptions. And I think in the first exercises, if we don't ask for them, you shouldn't implement them. I think starting from exercise 5 or something, we are saying all exceptions generated should be handled or something like this. So we give you small hints in the text whether you should use exceptions. And before we move on, I would like to remind you that the next lecture is on Tuesday, and it will be in Kalmar. So for the people here in Växjö, you can relax and take a look at the recording in the afternoon. And the people in Kalmar, you will have your first chance to meet me. It's your pleasure. Yeah. Yeah, so there is no lecture here in Växjö on Tuesday. So always read the time plan carefully, because in the time plan it says Växjö or Kalmar. So you don't show up here with an empty classroom. And
any live lecture using when you're in Calmo?
Yeah. It will be the same. It will be live. And if you read on the website, there is a link that you can go and take a look at it. Yeah. Anyway, let's move on. Object-oriented programmers, we like this idea of separation of concerns, that we have a public user interface that the user is using, and then we have implementation details that are hidden. We like it to the extent that we have come up with something called interfaces. An interface looks like a bit odd class. Rather than having public class something here, we have public interface. An interface is a set of methods with no implementation. You cannot execute an interface. They are just telling us what do we mean by an integer list. And with an integer we mean something that has a method called add, get, contains, and size in this short example. It is just specifies what we mean by an int list. So the idea is that this is the one that the user should only care about. We will have this, the interface is just a thin line providing a number of entry points like this. The user should be interacting with the interface. Behind it, we will have our class that implements the same thing, that gives an implementation to it. But the user should basically work with the interface and use these methods, and he shouldn't care about these guys behind here. The advantage is that if I realize that my implementation for the list was not good, it was had problems, I can remove this entirely and insert a new one. The user, he will not know. So this is the basic idea between interfaces. It is these methods that only comes with a signature, a name, a return value, and in parameters. They are called abstract methods. They only provide basic information, but they don't do anything. So if you have an interface like this, you cannot write new int list. The compiler will complain and say int list is not an executable type or something like this. Yeah. I think we go over here. Yeah. Then I'm providing one implementation of the int list interface. So here I have an ordinary class, array int list, that implements the int list. So what we are saying here is this is an implementation that provides whatever was expected in this one. This one says that an int list should look like this, and this one can handle it. This is what we are doing here. So this is the one that will be the one behind here. If later on I don't like this one, I can replace it and so something else. But this statement up here is the class array list, and it implements the int list. It means it must implement all the methods. If you try to avoid certain methods in this interface, the compiler will tell you that no, it's not correct. You must also implement this method. If you insert an add method with a different parameter and a different return value, the compiler will say that no, this is not the correct implementation of this interface. It must be an add method that takes an integer and returns void. So this one promises a certain functionality. This one implements or provides the promised functionality. Let's go back and see how we can use it. So in the code, I could write something like this. I am introducing a variable list here of the interface type. And then I'm assigning it here a new array int list. This one fulfills all the promises of this one, so I can assign it. And then later on here, I can only use methods that are declared in this one. Later on, if I come up with the idea that this was not good, then I can replace this piece of code with a new implementation, but all the other things will work as it is. If you are using interfaces correctly, you can do a lot of stuff. It's only at the point in the code where we are deciding, well, I would like to have this type of objects. Then you are specifying, I would like to have the array int list implementation of this interface. If you change your mind, you can just change this code. Everything else will work. Then it's just a trivial. I'm creating a list. I'm adding 10 different values. I'm iterating over it, saying from I equals to 0 to the size of it. And then I'm picking them out all one at a time and print their values. And this is my implementation. In order to implement a list is basically an array that grows on demand. If you add 100 values or 1,000 values, it shouldn't matter. It should always adapt itself to the number of added values. And this is how I implement it. I keep track of the values are stored in an array. And as you remember from the first lecture, an array is a fixed size. You can't not increase the size of an array. It's constant. So I keep track of the current size of the array, and I keep track of the next element that is available in this array. I'm adding things to it, and then I check if the length of the array is the same as the top element, then I must grow. We are about to run out of space in the array. So then I'm calling the resize method. And the resize method here, it creates a new array which is twice as long as the old one. We are multiplying the current length with the 2 and updates length. We are creating a new array of length 8 in the first time it's called. Then we are iterating over all the values here, move them to the new array here. And then we are replacing values up here with this new array. So the idea is that we have added 4 values, 6 and 2, and we are about to add a 5th value. Then the add method here, it realizes it. We are about to add one value too much. We are calling the resize method. We are creating a new array which is twice as long. And then we are moving all the ones over here. And then we start to use this one as our backup array. And then we add the new element, 11, over here. This is the basic idea. Why do I make it twice as long? Why not just one step longer? Why do I... Yeah. Every time I'm adding a new element, I would have to do these steps. Create a new array, move them along like this, and then add an element here. The next element, I do the same thing. So the standard approach is to always make it twice as long.
The performance of that is low.
What?
Because of the performance.
Yeah. Not having to create new arrays and shuffle elements from one array to another all the time. We do it, make it twice as long. People have come up with that this is a good idea. We're not making it 10 times as long. We're making it 2 times longer. So 4, 8, 16, 32, it starts to grow rather quickly after a while. Yeah. Do you understand how this one works? So. This was just one possible implementation of this int list. In the next lecture, I will talk about this int list interface. In the next lecture, I will talk about another approach to implement the list. They have different advantages and disadvantages. And if, as a user, you are not happy with this one, you can replace it with the other one if you have used the interface. If you're always working with the interface, you can easily change one implementation to another implementation. So this was the introduction to classes and interfaces, most importantly. And I also introduced a few keywords that are often used when you are thinking about implementing larger system. Modularity. We are dividing our program or the problem into smaller sub-problems until we are reaching classes, which is our basic building block. Abstraction. That means we should try to model an entity in such a way that it works in this particular context. It doesn't have to work in all contexts. We are picking out the certain values to say that to represent a student, in this case, I only need 5 different values. And then encapsulation. Hide internal details, do not expose sensitive data, provide a user-friendly interface. This divides the responsibility between the guy who is implementing it and the one who is using it. The guy who is implementing it should make sure that the fields are always in an up-to-date or correct state. The one using it should read the documentation and use them accordingly. That's his responsibility. Let's move on to something completely different. Exceptions. What is an exception? Yeah, it is the way to signal that something has gone wrong. It is a specific type of objects that are carrying information about something got wrong and probably a message saying what was wrong in this case. You should not use system out to write an error message. If you're implementing a list and they try to access an element that doesn't exist, you should raise an exception. Saying out of range, you try to reach 100, the 100th element, but we only have 5 elements in the list currently. So this is the standard mechanism of handling errors as a programmer. Here I have a very simple piece of code. And there are the main method here that starts the program, and we have the method here, myDivide, who will divide A by B. I introduce 2 variables, p and q. P gets the value 7 and q gets the value 0. And then I enter the try block here. Try block signals that we are entering a piece of code that might go wrong. And what we are doing here is that we are calling the myDivide method. With p and q, we are trying to divide, we are trying to compute p divided by q. And of course, dividing by 0 will not work. So my method here that performs the division, it starts by checking, is the second one 0? In this case, I'm generating an exception. This part of the code is create a new exception object, and throw here means that it should be handled in a certain way. So we are throwing an exception. Assuming that the q was not 0 but 1 in this case. In this case, this one would not be true. In that case, we would only compute a divided by b and return the value. And we should print p divided by 1 here is 7 in this case. Nothing would happen. It is only when they are giving you, submitting the number 0 here, that this one is executed. During execution, what happens is that, well, we start our program up here. We are defining this, introducing these variables. We reach this part. We make a call to myDivide, submitting these values. Then the execution jumps to this piece of the code. It makes a check here, and it throws an exception. Then the program stops. The program stops immediately and does not continue executing whatever remains here. It doesn't execute this line either. It goes backwards in some way until it finds a catch statement. We enter the try block here. We will do something dangerously, something might go wrong. We are calling a method, which might call a method and do something else. Something goes wrong, the execution stops, and we continue here. This one is to catch the exception. We are trying to do something dangerous, and we are catching the result. So if we are adding zero, this line will be executed. And the next line to be executed is actually this one. Yeah, I think. It might look like this. We are making a call to method A with some imparameters. We are calling A here. Then we are jumping to the method A. And then we execute the code here. We might call a method B here. Then we jump to the method B. We are jumping here. We are jumping here. And then we execute here. And here we have throw an exception. Somewhere in the code we have an exception. We are throwing an exception of a certain type X. Then it will look, am I surrounded by a catch block here? No, I'm not. Then it goes backwards to this point and asks, am I surrounded by a catch block here? No, I'm not. It jumps back here. Am I surrounded? And here we have catch. Yes, I am. Then it jumps to this line. So we have an exception over here, many methods away. It will go backwards in some sense and try to find the first surrounding catch block of a correct type. Did you understand how it works? Yeah.
Every time we are moving twice, we should catch.
Yes. I think, no, you don't have to, but try and catch, they come together. Try means we enter an area of code where we expect something goes wrong.
And the type of E always should be exception?
No. I will explain this later on. Yeah, I will. So, Java handles all errors and abnormal conditions using exceptions. As a programmer, you are responsible for a cross. If you see that something goes wrong, you should raise an exception. That's the standard way of signaling that something is wrong. It is a specific object that encapsulates information about an error. The program throws or raises an exception. This says, we have found that something is wrong, I'm raising an exception. And then execution halts, we go backwards until we found an enclosing catch statement or exception handler, catch, something like this. That's what happens. If we don't have any exceptions here, the code will go on here and move, go on here, move and go on, and this one will not be executed. Yeah. If I had this program in my main method, and I skipped this part and this part, I only made this dangerous one, then I will not catch the exception within my program, but the Java virtual machine, the one who is executing your program, it will catch it and kill your program with an error message. So not catching an exception is considered to be bad coding practice, but it will not harm your machine in any way. So you shouldn't be afraid of using it. In general, it's almost impossible to write a Java program that ruins the hardware of your machine in some way. So you should never be afraid of trying something out. It will not harm your machine. So the advantages is that it's a uniform handling of all errors or abnormal conditions. If something goes wrong, you throw an exception. The only thing you should decide is what type of exception you should generate. But there are 50 different types already available, so you are just picking one that sounds good. In this case, index out of bounds exception might be an appropriate one. There is also arithmetic exception, IO exception when you're reading from files and things like this. So you just pick one of them and you generate it. Like this. Yeah?
The difference is that of these exception objects is that they have different properties or different methods?
Yes, they have a few. Yeah. First of all, this was my initial example. I'm selecting, I think that this error here, dividing by zero, is a type of arithmetic exception. So this one suits me, and I provide a bit of information. In the catch statement here, I receive it and I ask, give me the message. It will write an arithmetic exception occurred in this particular line with the message dividing by zero. You can also ask it for something called a stack trace. A stack trace is basically, it will say that an error occurred in this method B at line 64. And this one was reached from this method at line 23, which was called initially from this method at line. It gives a more extensive, it points out not only where the error occurred, but which path we took to reach this one. So you will often, you've done a bit of programming already. Have you had any exceptions?
No.
Yeah, it prints, it comes out rather ugly with a bit of red on it. It is this stack trace. If you take a look at it, it will say that an error occurred here, and then it points out how you reach this one, and it will end up somewhere in your program. This is the entry point of the exception. So it contains quite a bit of useful information, this stack trace. So the next time, take a look at it and try to understand it. It will help you. Finding out that an error occurred at a certain point, well, it is useful. This was the error. But how did I reach this point is also useful information to understand what the error is all about. Yeah. Separation of responsibilities. Yeah, we like this separation. We are thinking that we are working in a team, and it's good to know who is responsible for what. The programmer identifies a problem and raises an exception. In our previous example, you were implementing a list or stack. If someone tries to pop an empty stack, you are raising an exception. You are identifying that something is wrong. If they try to assign 365 as a value of seconds, you raise an exception. That's your task as an implementer of a class. You will find out that something is wrong. The user determines how to handle the problem. He receives an exception. He can ignore it and continue, recover, try again, terminate it. So we are saying that the programmer is responsible for identifying error and raise an exception. The user of the class, well, he decides how to handle it. And as a programmer, it is impossible to guess how my class should be used. I have no idea whether they would like to stop or continue or try again. So we do something that is difficult. This is dangerous, and as a user of the class, I can decide that, okay, if an error occurs here, an exception occurs here, I will try again. I can decide, just ignore it. So we are dividing the responsibilities, separation of responsibilities. Yeah, as I said, there are a large number of predefined exceptions. You can implement your own exception. There is one class here, application exception. It is designed for you to take this one as your starting point to implement your own exception. I rarely ever do it. There are so many exceptions available that I just pick one of them and say, and then I give a message pointing out more specifically, which is the what was the reason for the error here. But pick one of the existing ones. Also, we are dividing our exceptions into two categories. We have those that are runtime exceptions. You don't need to handle them. For example, indexing out of bounds in an array. If you're indexing out of bounds, it will throw an exception, but you don't have to enclose it with a try and catch block. I will later on, I think in just two slides from now, show how to read from a file. This is a dangerous operation. The file might be lost or corrupt or something like this. If you want to open a file and read from it, you must catch an exception. Otherwise, the compiler will complain. This type of exceptions that must be handled are called handled exceptions. They must be handled. So sometimes you can always enclose any code with a try and catch block, but you don't have to. But sometimes you have to do it. We have something called an error. Exceptions are the common one. There is also something called an error. Have you received an error in your code? No. You have? Error message. When did you get it?
Before compiling, after compiling.
No, at runtime you can receive an error.
Maybe no much RAM left?
Yeah, out of memory. As a programmer, I cannot generate an error. It's only the Java virtual machine who can generate an error. But it means something is seriously wrong. I have to stop. That's the message from the Java virtual machine. We are out of memory, out of battery. Something is... And he gives you a small hint. He sends out an error before he dies. But if you receive an error, then you should understand that something is terribly wrong. In most cases, we are working with exceptions. You are generating exceptions when something goes wrong. The classes you are using from the library, they will generate exceptions if you are misusing them in some way. You can catch them and do whatever you want with it in this case. Here is another example. I am having an integer of array 5, and then I try to assign position 99 and value 24. This will obviously generate an exception. We are out of range of the array. What you see here is two catch statements and then something called finally. You can have many catch statements saying that if it was this type of error, then we should do this. If it was this type of error, then we should do that. And this one always executed once the try block entered. Here we try to save whatever can be saved. You could, for example, close files, save data, close networks connection or database connections. You start to do something dangerously, but you would like to make sure that certain things don't get lost. Then you insert them in the finally block. It tries and it almost always succeeds. And before it dies, it executes the lines of code that you have added up here. So the more general version of the try-catch block looks like this. We have one try where we do something dangerously. We have a number of catch statements where we catch different type of errors and handle them in a different way if we would like to. And then we have the finally block here that is also optional. You don't need to have it. But if you want to do something before you die or something else, you add the code in here. So this is the more general try-catch statement. Okay? Yeah. I should also say that the exceptions I point out here, this is a hierarchy. This is the highest type of exception. All these exceptions fits into this one. all these guys in here, they fits into the runtime exception. This one is one type of arithmetic exception. So what we are doing here is basically that we are picking out one particular type of exception, and if this one was the one happening here, we do something. Here I'm saying, okay, all the rest are handled in this way. This will take any exception that is generated. So you can have several cut statements, and you need to be aware of this hierarchy of statements. If you want to catch everything, you take this one. If you want to only to catch this type of exceptions, you have this catch statement before you're catching this one. Reading file. In one of the assignments, I think you should count words. We have given you an article about the Spanish golfer Sergio Garcia, and we want you to count, what was it, words or characters, or count different things in it. You must read it. And reading a file, it used to be rather difficult to read a file, or a lot of coding needed to read a file, but nowadays it's rather simple. This is a new entity for you. It's a class called file, and it represents a file. So if you want to read the text in this file, you are creating a new file object, and you say, okay, this is the particular file that I'm interested in. And then I'm just printing a bit of information here, reading file, and then get absolute path. It will point it out from C colon in your Windows, or from backslash user in your Mac. It will point out the exact path of this file. And then we are not connecting the scanner to the keyboard. We are connecting the scanner to this file. So rather than reading from the keyboard as we did yesterday, we are now saying that we are interested in reading from this file. So create a file, give it to the scanner, and then ask the scanner to, as long as we have more data, give me one line at a time, and then we print it. So read from a file, create the file object pointing to the file that you're interested in, create the scanner and give the file to it, and then use the scanner to say, often it looks like this, as long as it has more data, give me one character at a time, or in this case, give me one line at a time. And then you have read the entire line. Here I'm just printing it out. You will do a bit of counting for each line you see here. Okay? Yeah. Reading from a file is dangerous. What can go wrong? Give me what?
The file is missing.
The file is missing. Or it's not at the place where you expect it to be. It can be protected. You cannot open it. You don't have the rights to open it. It can not be a text file. You try to read a line, but it's only binary data or something like this. A lot of things can go wrong when you're reading from a file. That's why you must insert file manipulations inside a try block. And you must have be prepared to catch I/O exceptions. I/O is, of course, input output. Anything that goes wrong will generate an I/O exception. And here I'm printing the stack trace to see what was wrong. And then you should always close the file. Reading from a file is not that, there's not that many things that can go wrong if you don't close it. But it's worse if you're connecting to a network or a database. It might be that you're leaving the database in some condition which is not good. And if you're cutting it off abruptly, you might actually damage the database in some way. So take it as a habit of every time you're opening something, you should close it. Also in Eclipse, if you try to run this code in Eclipse and you don't have the final, you don't close it, Eclipse will give you a warning. Have you seen in Eclipse that there are yellow messages, red messages, it's an error, you cannot run it. But they can also give a yellow message, it's a warning saying, it's not good to do this. We are recommending you to fix it, and you should try to fix it. They are not handing out warning in vain. They often have a good reason for it. Here I do the same thing. I mean, well, I'm reading from another file, but that's basically, I'm reading from a file. I don't have any catch statement here. I don't have any try, and I don't have any catch. What I'm doing is that I'm handing over the responsibility to someone else. You can replace try and catch with you add to the method that this one might throw IO exceptions. Then it's the one who calls this method who will get the, he must handle it in some way. But this is not considered, your colleagues will not be happy with you if you use this approach a lot. You are too lazy to use a correct catch mechanism, so you're giving it away to the one using it. Not good. But if you're lazy, if you just should write a small main method trying to read from a file, rather than going on with try and catch IO exception, you can use this approach. Finally, in the previous version of Java, in 1.7, they introduced a new type of try statement. It's called try with resource. It looks like this. Try, and then we have a bracket. And here we are opening a resource, a file. And then we use it inside here. The advantage is that it makes the code smaller. You don't have to close things and like that. So this piece of code in here is actually the same as in the first version I sent you, but it's much, much shorter. You earn a bit of coding if you're using this approach. And it's suitable every time you're opening something, use it, and then close it. Then you should use this one. But this is identical. If you take a look at the compiler, if you take a look at what the compiler is doing, he reads this code and he generates bytecode. In this case, he will rewrite this code until it looks like version 1, and then it will generate bytecode for that one. So it's just what we are calling syntactic sugar to simplify the programming. It doesn't affect anything of the execution. Finally, visit, no, not finally. This program, the program will visit, I'm providing a directory here. Teaching directory. It will visit the directory teaching and all its subdirectories. For each directory, it will print its name and the number of contained files and subdirectories. So I give it one directory, teaching. Oops, it starts to get messy here. Teaching. It takes this one as the starting point and visit all the subdirectories here. And in each directory it visits, it will say, well, this one contained 38 files, or something like this. And this is handled in this short piece of code. I start by specifying the start directory here, and then I call this method. This method, it takes this file and asks, give me all your files. And then it iterates over all these files and picks them out one at a time from this array. And if this one that it picks out is a directory, then it calls itself using this subdirectory instead. A method calls itself, what is it called? Recursion. Yeah. This one describes what to do with a directory. It checks what is the content of it. It goes through the content, and if it contains another directory, then it calls itself again using this directory. So it will traverse all the directories. As long as there are subdirectories, it will traverse it. I would like to point out that this class file is very useful. You can create a file object pointing to a file or a directory, as in this case. And you can ask it a lot of questions. Is it write protected, read protected, things like this. So you can ask it if it is a folder, what is your parent folder, what are your subfolders, a lot of things. So if you're interested in writing some piece of program that manipulates your file system, this is the go-to place. Read up on it. Finally, a class that I should have been introduced earlier on. This is, well, the most frequently used class in my programs.
About the that code, service code. For the first directory, there should be a print.
Yeah.
Where is print?
If it is a subdirectory, then I'm printing the name of this one, and I'm printing how many files. Before I visit it, the next directory, I print its name, and I ask this one, sub, what is the, how many files do you contain?
For loop directory, I mean. For loop directory, what is the link for loop directory?
Good.
Loot, R-O-O-T.
I don't understand the word.
The
root. Okay, in this case, let's take a look. No, this one will not be printed. It will start printing information about this one. Yeah. Yeah. Most frequently used classes from the class library. Well, without doubt, the most frequently used class in the class library is the string class. We are using strings everywhere. But then I would guess almost that ArrayList is the second most frequently used. It is an array, but it can grow on demand. So if you would like to store data and you don't know how many data you will add to it, you should use an ArrayList. You are creating a list, and then you start to say add, and you can add millions. You don't need to give it a size to it. It will grow and adapt itself to fit your needs. So this one is very useful. It comes in two versions, a raw version where you can add anything. You can add a string, an integer, a student after each other. And there's something called the generic version where you can only add one type of data. When you're creating the array list, you're saying that this is an array list only for strings. And if you try to add an integer, the compiler will complain. So raw version can take any type of data. Generic versions are when you're constructing them, you're saying that this one should only be for integers or this one for strings. You decide what type of data they should use. I will show an example of both of them. This one is using the raw version. We are creating a new array list. This one is in the Java util library, so you need to import it. But we are creating an empty list like this. And then we are iterating over a number, and we are adding the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to this one. Then we are printing the list. We are sending the entire list to the system out print line. It will print 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It will print exactly like this. Then we are adding 99 to the second position. We are actually inserting it. We are not overriding it. We are adding it at the second position. So we are position 0, 1, 2. We insert 99 here and we move the other ones one step backwards. Remove the element at position 1. We are removing 0, 1. We are removing this one. So it is a container of data where you can add things front, back, in the middle. You can remove things front, back, in the middle. You can use the contains method to ask, do you contain number 73? Very useful. every time you should store a larger number of data, I recommend you to start using the array list. There are other options of data structure, but this one is very handy and it works very well. The problem with using the raw version is that when you're adding something to it, it can take any type of data. So when you're picking it out, the program don't know what comes out. So when you're picking out an element from it here, we are asking the list, give me the element position 0. In order to assign it to a variable, I must say that I know that it is an integer here. So it comes out without any type, and you have to say, I know that this one is an integer, and before you can assign it to a variable.
Is there a way to check what type of object is there in the specific position?
No. No, it's not. Yes, in. Yeah, but it's clumsy. You shouldn't know. Basically, you should be very careful in having data structures like this and store a student in one, a string, an integer, string, integer, integer, string. In the end, you will mess it up and try to pick out an integer from position 7, but it turns out that at that position was a string. So it's messy to have heterogeneous data collections. Yeah, well, I will show the generic. So this is the problem with the raw one. It's easy to use. You can add it like this, but you must remember that when you're picking them out, they have an unknown type, and you must force it into a variable like this. Yeah, I can go to the other example. Here we are using the generic version. When I'm creating the array list here, I'm specifying that this one is for integers. This type of bracket here says that this is an array list, but it can only take integers. The advantage is that when we are picking things out from it, we don't have to do this downcasting. The compiler knows that this particular list can only enter integers, so what comes out must be an integer. So this is the generic version, and you are recommended to use this one. Assume that we have a program, and we have a list that is working with integers, and at some point here, I am adding hello to it. If we are, and then later on somewhere, I am picking out an element, and I expect it to be an integer, and I'm picking out this one, I will have an error here. I will try to pick out, it turns out what I'm picking out is not an integer as I expect, it turns out to be a string, and I'm trying to convert a string to an integer and it will not work. We will have an exception, typecast exception here. If I were using a generic list and I had declared it like this, and all of a sudden, I try to insert a string into it, the same scenario. Then I will have a compile error. The compiler will say that you are trying to add a string to an integer list. So in both cases, I will have an error in my code. Which scenario is better?
The second one.
Immediately you type the code saying, I would like to add this one. The compiler will recognize it and point out, no, it's not correct. This one, trying to pick it out, appears much later when you're running the code. It might be difficult to find out, where did I add this string? So this is the major reason why, if you want to have an array and you should only store one type of values, you should always use the generic version of it. It's type safe, as it's called. It gives you an error message instantly if you try to misuse it in some way. And you will see that Eclipse, this program here. When I'm creating a raw array list like this, Eclipse will immediately give you a warning. A red, yellow sign saying that this is not good. We don't want you to use this one. Consider using a generic version. So this was the old approach. This is the new approach. And it's the recommended one. I have a list here of methods from the array list class, the raw version. A constructor, you need to create it somewhere. It should be a C here. It creates a new empty list. You can add things using this method. It appends it, actually. You can add it at a certain position. You can clear it. That means remove all elements from it. You can do whatever you want with an array list. So create them and then take a look at the Java documentation to see what you can do with it. There are a lot of methods. You can add at any place and remove at any place, and basically you do a lot of stuff. Yeah. Object here, I should just say, we will describe it in the fourth lecture when it comes to inheritance. But for the time being, you can think of it as a type that fits everything. So in the raw version, you can add an object. It means you can add whatever. When you are removing things, you will get an object. It means we don't know what it is. It can be anything. So for the time being, consider object just as a wildcard, saying any type will do, or any type will come out. I think that was it. You have a new set of exercises. Go home and practice, and if you run into trouble, I think the first practical meeting in Växjö will be on Thursday, and in Kalmar it will be on Tuesday, next Tuesday.